During his final years, Dvořák became the recipient of various honours. In 1897, he was appointed as a member of the jury for the Viennese Artists' Stipendium. In 1898, he was elected a member of a committee of experts on copyright in music. In 1901, he became a member of the House of Lords of the Austrian government, and in November 1901, he was appointed director of the Prague Conservatory. As for his compositional activities, Dvořák stated, "Over the last few years, I have written nothing but operas, not out of vanity or desire for fame, but because I consider opera the most advantageous of genres for the nation, too. Large sections of society hear such music, and hear it very often." Opera, not a genre we tend to associate with Dvořák, a composer much better known for his orchestral and chamber music. Nonetheless, as historians have argued, there was practically no period of his life when Dvořák was not engaged in one operatic project or another. This, his final period, simply saw a burst of creative energy in operatic composition. As Dvořák's words make clear, a substantial part of opera's appeal to the composer was, in fact, opera's own appeal as a genre, the ability of opera to draw an audience, a large mixed audience, one that represented a cross-section of society. The composer's mention of the nation, too, is surely important. Whether it be an opera that depicts the nation, a period in its history, its folk heritage or mythology, or an opera that attracts the nation, luring paying customers into the theatre, Dvořák's homeland figures prominently in his creative vision. Here, towards the end of his life, we find Dvořák writing two new Czech national operas, The Devil and Kate, based on a Czech fairy tale, and Rusalka, also a fairy tale, and also on a Czech libretto. Moreover, if we look back over the composer's career, we also find important Czech-based operas, including King and Charcoal Burner, mentioned earlier, and the lesser-known The Jacobin, set in a Bohemian village in the 18th century. But focusing on these Czech operas, and these operas alone, gives a false impression. For prominent within Dvořák's compositional career, even here during the twilight years of his life, is a marked interest in historical opera of a distinctly international appeal. Indeed, Dvořák's very first attempt at opera, The Grand and Heroic Alfred, was set to a story about the English King Alfred the Great. Later came Dmitri, a slice of Russian history following the death of Tsar Boris Godunov. And then his last completed work, Armida, based on an epic poem by the 16th century Italian writer Torquato Tasso, The Liberation of Jerusalem. The opera depicts events unfolding during the First Crusade, with a focus on a passionate relationship between the title character, the daughter of King Hydriot of Damascus, and the crusading knight Rinald, two characters from two opposing camps. Important to the plot is the exotic locale, the backdrop against which the romance unfolds. Dvořák captures this oriental setting from the very start of Act 1, Scene 1, where, in the royal gardens of Damascus, the traditional call to prayer is heard. The muezzin's proclamation of the greatness of Allah is interspersed between contrasting choral passages. Ethereal-sounding female voices sing of peaceful days of contentment, while a male choral recitative with rhythmically defined repeated notes captures the menacing goings-on in the desert.